Service General, I call Ms. Nayla Dessa, Deputy County Manager, to read our safety instructions.
Good evening. To provide for the safety of those attending this meeting, please listen to the following instructions in case of an emergency. First, please take a moment to note where your exits are. If an emergency arises that prompts us to evacuate, please exit this room in a quick and orderly manner through one of the two doors to your right, and then proceed to the nearest stairwell, directions to which are indicated by the exit signs. Once you exit the building, we ask that you safely cross Granville Street, the street that runs beside our building, to our parking lot to be safely away from the building. Our staff will help provide direction and assistance. In the case of a tornado warning, we ask that you exit this room into the hallway, where we will all remain until it is safe to exit. In the event of an active shooter in the building, if there is an accessible escape path, please run and try to evacuate the premises. If you can't evacuate, find a place to hide where you are less likely to be found and lock any doors that you can. And as a last resort, and only if your life is in imminent danger, please fight. Our staff will provide additional assistance on what to do. Thank you for your attention.
Eternal God, our Father, we give so much thanks for entering into the 11th month of the year. As time swiftly goes by, help us to celebrate the life of those who have seen longevity in their lives. Then bless our minds and our hearts. We might consider the thing that makes our county a better place in which to live. Through Christ our Lord, we do pray. Amen.
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 Lord, it's an honor tonight to honor three of our, I always miss that.
I understand the next one is excited.
Yes, okay.
Motion to approve the minutes.
Second.
Question. All in favor, let me know by the votes on aye.
Aye.
All opposed, hearing none, the minutes are now approved. I guess I was kind of excited to get to the next agenda item because we all know. Centurarians, is that correct? Okay. If I mess it up, I have staff help me with that, okay? But we are so honored to have these three young ladies in our presence. And we're trying, all of us are trying to get there. But what we'll do, I'll take these in order of these agenda, and what I'm going to do is Ms. Cassie Smith, she's here. Ms. Powell, would I ask you to read that resolution and ask the board to approve it and make you, and you make that presentation.
Okay. Let's see.
Please.
Okay. Resolution in celebration of 106th birthday of Cassie Smith. Whereas the members of Edgecombe County Board of Commissioners and eight, oh, she is 108. Okay. The members of the Edgecombe County Board of Commissioners believe that all our citizens contribute to the greatness of our county. Yet there are some whose impact or their important milestones are worthy of our recognition. And whereas Ms. Cassie Smith is undoubtedly deserving of such recognition for reaching an amazing milestone. And whereas Ms. Cassie Smith has celebrated her 108th birthday, and we join her and her family in rejoicing in her longevity and vitality. Now, therefore, be it officially resolved and publicly noted that Edgecombe County Board of Commissioners honors Ms. Cassie Smith and wishes her a happy 108th birthday. The 7th day of November 2022, signed by Little Bishop, chair of our board, and attested by Franklin and Kumango, our clerks.
I'll make that motion. Do I have a second? All in favor, let me know by the vote of aye.
Aye.
All opposed, hear none. This resolution is approved. Please make that presentation.
She's also being DK Butterfield's office and by the governor. Well, Cooper sent you a letter too. Everybody loves you. Deserving such recognition for reaching an amazing milestone as well. And whereas Ms. Pauline Lawrence has celebrated her 106th birthday, and we join her and her family in rejoicing longevity and longevity. Now therefore, we officially resolve and publicly noted that the Edgecombe County Board of Commission honors Ms. Pauline Lawrence a happy 106th birthday on the 7th. Unfortunately, Ms. Lawrence kind of fell ill today, but she's doing okay. She's not here to ask her passion.
We happen to have a daughter-in-law in one of our centenarians here, okay? Ms. Harris, we're going to ask you to read that resolution, please.
Resolution in celebration of the 103rd birthday of Lucille Harris. Whereas the members of the Edgecombe County Board of Commissioners believe that all of our citizens contribute to the greatness of our county, yet there are some whose impact or their important milestones are worthy of our recognition. And whereas Ms. Lucille Harris is undoubtedly deserving of such recognition for reaching an amazing milestone, whereas Ms. Lucille Harris has celebrated her 103rd birthday on October 11th, and we join her and her family in rejoicing in her longevity and vitality. Now, therefore, be it officially resolved and publicly noted, the Edgecombe County Board of Commissioners honors Ms. Lucille Harris and wishes her a happy
'cause she has been my mother-in-law for 42 years.
That deserves an applause.
Unlike many daughters-in-law, I can really say she has been a great mother-in-law. Not in our 42 years have we argued. Not in our 42 years has she taken her son's side against me. Not in our 42 years, and I can tell you a lot of daughter-in-laws cannot say that. So I am honored to present you not only with these flowers, but a letter from the governor. Congratulations on the celebration of your 103rd birthday. Reaching such a milestone is quite a blessing and not without the challenges of life we all encounter. The wisdom and strength you have gathered has been passed from one generation to the next, and is a priceless gift. G.K. Butterfield, also sent. As this blessed and special milestone in your life, I am honored to extend my best wishes to you on the occasion of your 103rd birthday. Your many years of dedication to family and community are greatly appreciated. I pray that God will continue to bless you with health and happiness for many more years to come. And she has her nieces and nephews here, if you please stand, and her and another daughter-in-law.
And since I'm trying to get there, we stand in recess for 5 minutes, okay? I'd like to say, congratulations. Didn't want this achievement. We stand in recess for 5 minutes. Let's give all of them a round of applause.
I want my family to come on.
Guys to come out and get a picture with you and Miss Cassie.
You know Miss Cassie.
Yes.
Look at me.
Right there on that seat. You got it.
You want to take my case out?
Well, if they want to, I don't know what they're going to do. I'm going to take it out. You got my mom's stuff.
Ma'am.
Call the board meeting back to order. At this time, ladies and gentlemen, we have scheduled appointments. We have a petition, public petition. Is there anybody here from the public that would like to address the board at this time?
See what this is, just to remind you, when we transitioned Edgecombe County Rescue Squad in-house, all of their assets were transferred in. That included a fund that they referred to as the Jefferson Fund, and that was where they raised money, received donations. That was transferred in with their assets as well. And so we received that, became part of our fund balance. We did not reappropriate that back into emergency services on the EMS line. So you'll see this budget amendment is to appropriate that under capital outlay for purchase of equipment in emergency services. If you look at budget amendment number three, the ABC board has appropriated funds to Edgecombe County to cover travel costs related to economic development projects, and so we are appropriating those funds in a travel line under economic development. Budget amendment number four, and actually this applies to budget amendments number four, five, and six. We underestimated phone costs in health department and various program lines, so you'll see budget amendments four, five, and six appropriating funds from fund balance to those telephone lines in the health department. Budget amendment number 17 that is in your agenda packet, I would like for that to be replaced with budget amendment number 17 that's at your seat. And that is a correction on that. We're pulling that money instead of from salaries from workman's comp. Also, we have two additional budget amendments. I would like to ask you to consider adding those, and they being budget amendments number 20 and 21. Those are fairly routine budget amendments from the health department. Those are at your seat as well. So I recommend that you approve budget amendments number 1 through 21 with that substitution of number 17. I have to answer any questions that you might have on
the motion.
The National Association of Counties, as well as the North Carolina Association of County Commissioners, is promoting and encouraging an effort called Operation Greenlight to show support for our veterans in the county. You can see just behind you, they sent out green bulbs for us to use over here in the corner. It's a green bulb. It will be down in our lobby for the remainder of the month, along with that, so people know that when they come into the building. You have a resolution, in your agenda packet tonight. I'd like to ask for Ms. Shara Johnson, who is our Veteran Services Officer, to come forward, and she is going to share with you and read this resolution.
Rock them out for
pre-COVID. I've just been doing what I've been doing for the past 8 years as far as helping out veterans and spouses and students or dependents alike as such as needing assistance in getting the benefits that they deserve. Myself and Eric, we spoke a few times as far as what we feel like, you know, or what I feel like the county is needing to go as far as assisting the veterans. And I think it would be more so as an education or right now we're short of drivers or volunteers as far as getting veterans to their appointments or actually getting to the veterans in nursing homes or at home, or they're in locations where they're not able to get to me. And being that I'm in Tarver and there's nobody in Rocky Mount, so we're not able to support the veterans as we did pre-COVID. So it's so many entities out there, as a matter of fact, everybody that I spoke to, that I reached out to them, from Troy, the town manager, to Edgecombe Community College, everybody's willing to assist in supporting the operation, green light as far as getting the information out to veterans, getting assistance to veterans, and I'm happy that everybody is jumping on board that I have reached out to, mainly the community college as far as being a military-friendly college, offering so much money, because at the same time, we talk about educating veterans, students, dependents alike. When I spoke to the VA coordinator at the community college, she was more than welcome to jump on board with Edgecombe and Rocky Mount as far as getting the students what they needed and all the programs out here to get to the vets. But vets are not really able to know what's available to them because they're not really informed on what's going on. What's out there to them. So it's, I would like to, whatever I can to do to assist in helping the veterans get whatever they need, veterans depends on life. It comes from the burial benefits to the military, the survivors, and everybody. Because once the veteran leaves, monetarily, it doesn't stop. Because then you have the survivor spouse, then you have the children. And then let's say you have, when we go back to the Camp Lejeune, contaminated water or the PAC Act law, that those commercials are being promoted more now because the people from Camp Lejeune that did file claims years ago were denied. But now that it's being approved, you're having more and more veterans coming back with surviving spouses that's coming back and saying, hey, my spouse or child or whatever was affected by the contaminated water. So now they are reimbursing these vets back to and the surviving family members, or it really is just anyone that was in the Camp area during that time. And we put the PAC Act law, that's the veterans that was exposed to a lot of particular matters when they were in Afghanistan, Kuwait, Iraq. There was a lot of falling when, you know, the burn pit, we were all exposed to the burn pits, and a lot of veterans were compensated for either chronic rhinitis, sinusitis, or but now they're going back and they're reimbursing, retro paying veterans that can show that they're affected by this way back. So it's a lot of money out there on the table now as far as changing their lives. We were at the conference last week, as a matter of fact, we have another conference coming up in Wilmington. We're looking at moving veterans or surviving spouses for life from public assistance to VA funding because we're talking at least $3,000 more in their paycheck, depending on how they are compensated or how they're rated, depending on how the disability affected them. So I do like the Operation Green Light. It's new, but it do promote and protect the veterans' dependents alike as far as the assistance that they are just to.
Would you want to read it?
Whereas the residents of Edgecombe County have great respect, admiration, and the utmost gratitude for all the men and women who have selflessly served our country and this community in the armed forces. Whereas the contributions and sacrifices of men and women who served in the armed forces have been vital in maintaining the freedoms and way of life enjoyed by our citizens. And whereas the Edgecombe County seeks to honor these individuals who have paid a high price for freedom by placing themselves in harm's way for the good of all, and whereas veterans continue to serve our community in the American Legion, veterans of foreign wars, religious groups, civil service, and function as Edgecombe
service officers in 29 states to help fellow former service members access more than $52 billion in federal health, disability, and compensation benefits each year. Whereas approximately 200,000 service members transition to civilian communities annually. And whereas an estimated 20% increase of service members will transition to civilian life in the near future. Whereas studies indicate that 42 to 72% of service members experience high levels of stress during transition from military to civilian life. Whereas active military service members transitioning from military service are at high risk for suicide during the first year after the military service. Whereas the National Association of Counties encourages all counties, parishes, and boroughs to recognize Operation Green Light Preparedness. Whereas the Edgecombe County Board of Commissioners appreciates the sacrifices of our United States military personnel, for these specific recognition should be granted. Therefore, it be resolved with designation as Green Light Preparedness County, the Edgecombe County Board of Commissioners hereby declares the month of November a time to salute and honor services and sacrifice of our men and women in uniform transitioning from the active service. And it be further resolved that it is in observance of Operation Green Light, Edgecombe County encourages its citizens and patriotic tradition to recognize the importance of honoring all those who have made immeasurable sacrifices to preserve freedom by displaying a green light in the rhythm of their place of business or residence. And I'll be Mr. Chair.
Is there
a
motion?
Question.
All in favor, let me know by the blue sign. Aye.
Aye.
All opposed. Petition of service. And thank you. Thank you for what you do. Any questions? One question.
Okay.
Question.
Now, she did say that she had moved from Rocky Mount to Carver. Is there any reason we can't divide up the time so that she spends a couple of days in Rocky Mount?
Sure, and that's what we're working back towards. And she was splitting time before here. And of course, the places where she had an office has changed as well. For a long time, our veterans office in Rocky Mount was in what used to be the unemployment office on Fairview Road. Of course, that closed down. She moved over to where the NC Works Career Center was. Now that has moved out. And so we're working towards getting her space at the health department office in Rocky Mount. So.
Also wanted to make sure we introduced Edgecombe Community College. That's representative.
This is VA Community, Edgecombe Community College,
VA Colonel. Hey, how are you? I'm Mia Chabellini. I am the Veterans Coordinator at Edgecombe Community College. My job as a school certifying official is to make sure we remain a military-friendly school. I can help students apply for their educational benefits and use their educational benefits. I make sure that they get their housing and food stipend. We offer contacts for transition to civilian life, PTSD counseling, and we even the veteran dependents are open to any counseling and stuff that we offer. We make sure they get their veteran benefits applied, get their book stipend and all that good stuff. So we appreciate Edgecombe County electing to be in Operation Green Light. We are definitely going to participate and, you know, show our appreciation to the veterans. So, we are working with our maintenance staff to light our flag pole in front of the Tarver campus and the Rocky Mount campus green this whole week because we really support our veteran students. And my job is to just make sure that transition from beginning to school to graduation happens for our veteran students. We do have a couple programs coming up this week in support of our veterans on Thursday, November 10th. We're offering free haircuts to all veterans from 9 to 1 on the Rocky Mount campus in the Warrens Building. And then Friday, we'll be having our veteran ceremony. If it rains, it'll be in the Cagney Auditorium at 11 a.m. Right, so I hope you guys join. And I will leave Ms. Johnson with some pamphlets about resources and all the things that we offer at Edgecombe for our veterans. I'll leave them with her so that she can share them with you.
With all the benefits and things that the veterans can have, why are so many veterans going lacking?
What was that last part?
Why are so many veterans going lacking or not being able to use these benefits or get these benefits?
I'm not sure. And it's crazy because post-pandemic, our enrolled veteran number decreased. But if they need assistance, a lot of them don't know how to apply for the benefits. VA.gov did kind of change up their website a little bit, and it may not be as user-friendly, but we do have labs located on both campuses, and we can have staff go in there and help them assist them applying for the educational benefits, whether they want to attend Edgecombe or not, because we are a school for the community. So if they would like to come to our campus, we're open 8 to 5 Monday through Thursday, 8 to 1 on Fridays, and we can help them apply for the educational benefits.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman, I'd like to acknowledge that I know Ms. Johnson is a veteran. We thank her for her service. And are there any other veterans here in the room?
Myself.
Thank you for your service. Next
on the agenda is item C regarding MOU for our rural planning organization. In 2002, Edgecombe County executed a memorandum of understanding along with Nash, Johnson, and Wilson counties, as well as their participating municipalities, which created the Upper Coastal Plain Rural Planning Organization. The RPO works with the North Carolina Department of Transportation on short-term and long-range transportation planning for our region. We collectively receive funding from NCDOT and provide a local match to cover staffing costs and planning activities. Nash County has served as the lead administrative and planning entity, but that role will now be assumed by the City of Wilson. Therefore, the enclosed MOU amends the agreement accordingly. I recommend that you approve the Memorandum of Understanding as presented.
A motion.
Motion.
Second.
Item D. The Human Services Bylaws currently state that both the Social Services Advisory Council and Health Advisory Council are to meet monthly to more closely study and discuss issues pertaining to social services and health in order to advise the Human Services Board. We have found that it has not been necessary to meet at all. Therefore, we propose amending the bylaws to require that they meet at least biannually. You will see the proposed change on page 6 of the bylaws. Each advisory council has the option to call a meeting if needed. This is forwarded with a favorable recommendation from the Human Services.
Motion.
Second.
Question.
Item E is bad debt write-off, which you see at least a couple times a year from the health department. You'll see in the attachment that it's a total of $4,794.86 to be written off and recommended to you.
Motion.
Second.
Questions? All in favor, let me know by the vote. Aye.
Aye.
All opposed? And none. It is approved.
Item F, regarding extraordinary pay policy. In the last couple of years, all employers have experienced higher than normal employee turnover. Edgecombe County has certainly not been the exception. Though there are multiple factors contributing to that, some of which may be debated, one undeniable result is that the same, if not growing, demand for government services has been shouldered by fewer people. Some departments have experienced that more than others. For our team members who are experiencing those extraordinary workloads, I would like to have the opportunity to provide additional but temporary compensation. Therefore, I present for your consideration the attached extraordinary pay policy. I will go through the policy with you in detail in just a moment. Unlike the hazard pay policy you previously approved, this will not be as widely applied. Department heads will have to request extraordinary pay for an employee and provide justification, anticipated duration, and a plan for how the extraordinary conditions will be mitigated. I would ask if you would turn to the next page of the policy itself. The first part under eligibility for overtime compensation under FLSA, those first four or five paragraphs, that all comes from our current personnel policy. It basically just sets the stage for this extraordinary pay policy. So just to let you know, that first part of it is already part of our personnel policy. But then under extraordinary premium pay, it says that that this represent payment for effort that is above and beyond normal work schedules and or work responsibilities for employees. It notes that it requires approval first from the department head and by me. To be eligible for extraordinary premium pay, the employee must be working above and beyond their normal duties on a special assignment or project during a time of exceptionally increased workload due to conditions such as abnormally high turnover within their department or unit, or significantly increased responsibility due to a temporary project or role assignment. It notes in here also that assignments or conditions that last less than 30 days will not be considered for extraordinary pay. If you approve this, what this will allow is a tool that we can use where we can apply up to 10% of their base pay for the period defined as that extraordinary pay period. That's approved by first the department head and then by me, and it cannot exceed 6 months. The department heads will be responsible for presenting a request to me for extraordinary pay, which must include the justification, as I mentioned a moment ago, the anticipated duration of activities, conditions, or assignment, and what measures will be taken to mediate those conditions or otherwise mitigate the need for extraordinary pay. Also, the department head will be responsible for ensuring consistent application of this policy within the department or unit, the accurate and timely recording and reporting of hours worked that are eligible for extraordinary pay, and maintaining budgetary constraints regarding premium payments. Happy to answer any questions. You've heard me talk about in the last several months, the real and ongoing challenge that we've had of high turnover, and I know a lot of employers have been experiencing that. We've seen it higher in some departments than other. In particular, our largest department, with the Department of Social Service, we've had an extremely high turnover in social service. It's nothing negative against the department. It's difficult work, and we've got much more competitive pay in some counties around us. Obviously, we want to try to address that in the long term, but in the short term, we need another tool to try to slow down that. Has not been a leak, it's really been quite a flow of employees in and out. And so the work in social service is hard, but extremely important. And so we've got, Ms. Battle has some units in her department where normally they may have in that unit six employees and might have one or two employees in that unit. And those caseloads do not slow down just because you don't have enough employees. She certainly can describe it much better than I can. Ms. Battle, you mind coming up? They have been facing a tremendous challenge, but I must say they have handled it very well. They've worked a lot of overtime, and they've done a great job of that, but I know it's a tremendous amount of pressure on her and her team. Anything else like that?
Well, you did pretty good. Good evening, everybody.
That's all you did.
As Ms. Evans stated, pretty much the extraordinary pay will assist us with retention. We've looked at some other things like remote work. We lose employees like constantly. I got four resignations this week. On my way out of the building this afternoon, I got a telephone call from the Wilson County DSF director to let me know that he's recruiting one of our, he's hiring one of our employees. She's only been with us six months. So they're coming in. One time, the county will not look at them unless they had at least a year of experience, not more. So they come in now and they got 3 months of their NC Pass work, and that's like something that most of these agencies now, if you can navigate NC Pass, they consider that a skill. If you got 2 or 3 months and you can navigate NC Pass, they're going to hire you. So they come in to us because we have to recruit, because it's difficult for us to get people here because our salaries are not as competitive with other counties. So they come in with us, they begin working with us because we're a training ground. That's what we call ourselves, a training ground. They come here, they work 6 months, 7, 8 months, and then they leave. They go to Wilson, Nashville, Pitt. because out of one of those counties is going to pay. As a matter of fact, the ex-interview that I got today from the young lady whose last day is Friday, she's going to Nash. She told me that she lives in Rocky Mount. She was working in Rocky Mount. So she's going to go across the railroad track. She's making 28 here, and she's going over to Nash to make 38, and it's only like right across the railroad track. So we can't compete with that because we're not Nash County, we're Edgecombe. So we discussed ways that we could retain some of the staff that we made that stay. So if they didn't know the first, we put a lot of employees out on what we call remote work, meaning that they would be working from home. And surprisingly, not as many volunteered as I anticipated, but it was enough, especially with senior workers, to make me feel a little comfortable that they would stay. They will be working from home, the supervisor will be providing them supervision, but that is an incentive because they don't have to pay for gas. They won't have to do daycare unless they choose to, because most of them keep that child right there at home. So it helps cut down on some of their expenses, which is an incentive for them to remain with the agency. So with the remote work and now this, some of the units that we're having a vacancy in, their average caseload, okay, like our food and nutrition unit, the average caseload is like 1,000, 200 or 300. If you have 5 people in that unit and 3 of them have resigned, who's going to do work? You have to assign those cases to the other 2 employees. And then they become overwhelmed and discouraged and they leave. One unit in child welfare is a 5 unit, it's a 5-team unit. And the only person in that unit right now is the supervisor. That's our in-home services unit, a very critical unit to help provide services to the families and child welfare. And the supervisor is the only person on that team at this moment. Now, we interviewed them last week, and we had 2 prospects. One accepted, one did not. So it's going to be the supervisor plus 1. But right now, she is the only person on her team. And it looks that way throughout the agency, not just in home services, but in food and nutrition and Medicaid. Those are the 2 programs that that have the highest caseload and that they experience the most urgency. Like the turnover is fierce in those 2 areas.
Uh-huh. Is all of this based on what the employee gets paid?
I think so. That's what they say when they leave. That's what they on their exit report, on their exit interview, because the cost of living is high, and they have to have money. And a lot of the employees that we have in social services are single parents, single moms.
But somewhere we all get tired of people coming and going.
Absolutely, I agree.
$300 for a baby to be in daycare. That's when you have her
daycare assistance.
Right.
And right now we have a waiting list for that because I'm glad you mentioned that. We have several employees. Actually, we have a lot of employees that apply that qualify for the services that we provide.
Exactly.
And so, they qualify for daycare, they qualify for food assistance, they qualify for the medical assistance because they meet the income level. And the income level is the federal level and it's considered poverty level.
Yep.
But that's what we're paying them.
Yep.
But again, the issue is still that we are not paying what other counties are paying. So they go to other counties after getting trained here.
That is correct.
What can we do to stop that?
I did a salary study. I did a study about 3 months ago, me and my former personnel assistant, and we did like 11 counties. And of course, we were at the bottom, of course. But even small counties like Halifax pay more than we do.
So that's something that would be considered.
Sure, and it's not a matter of us not knowing what we need to do. It's our ability to do it.
Right.
you know, obviously, and we've had many conversations. We talked at the budget work session, our retreat, and I appreciate you all, you know, working hard with us to move in that direction of putting our employees first. We've done a lot to help with that. We did a 4% cost of living this year. We've done consistently over the last 7 years cost of living every year of different amounts. You know, we did hazard pay, did a number of different things. And this won't be, this is not a silver bullet. This is just one more tool to add to help. But as far as what we really need to be able to do is take our entire pay scale and lift the whole thing up. And that right there is what would cost the county a lot of money there. At this point, we just do not have.
But it can't cost as much as it costs.
That's true, but if I do that, that means I'll have to take it from somewhere else.
It's not quite that easy. But I'm just saying, this is something that we've been talking about this for the last 20 years.
We may find out we start paying extraordinary pay and we're able, those people who are getting that are doing a lot of work, and we may not need as many people to get it done. We pay the people who are there more money. Possibly.
Maybe.
Plus, we got 1,400 people right now in Edgecombe County looking for a job. It sure is sad that we can't find we have an unemployment rate that's one of the highest in the state, 1,400 people.
But I think the bottom line of this is what we're discussing here. As we look at it, and I think this board has done an excellent job in terms of what we can do. You know, we have, you can't pay what you don't get. Your revenue, if your revenue is not there, you can't pay it. And I think this board has done an excellent job in trying to provide the services across all of the departments that we can afford based on the revenue that we've got. And I think that's part of what we've been trying to do with economic development in terms of as we can increase our revenue coming in. Then our top priority in our discussion with this board is our employees. That is our top important. That is our top priority. That would be our top priority as we look at the budget issue. Is there a motion to approve?
So moved.
Second. Questions? All in favor, let me know by the vote, say aye.
Aye.
All opposed, hearing none, we got that. Okay.
Thank you.
Next.
You have the holiday schedule for 2023 before you recommend it to approve.
Thank you. Questions? All in favor, let me know by the vote, say aye.
Item H, you previously approved an amendment to our solid waste ordinance to enact a solid waste permit requirement. As we prepare to renew those permits, we do that every 2 years. We recommend changing the ordinance to remove the specific reference to a placard, being that we will transition to an easier to manage form of permit. Other language is recommended to change for clarity. An ordinance change does require a public hearing to be held. I recommend that you call for the hearing, public hearing at your December 5th meeting.
Motion.
Second.
Question. All in favor, let me know by the vote, say aye. All opposed, hearing none, it is approved.
General statute allows you as a board to award a retiring officer his or her service weapon. And Sheriff Atkinson has requested consideration for Chief Deputy Gene Harrell to be retiring next month. Show the county's appreciation for his exemplary service and to provide for a memento to that service. I recommend that you approve the transfer of his service weapon at a price of $1 upon the retirement of Chief Deputy Gene Harrell.
Motion. Second. Question. All in favor, let me know by the vote, sign aye.
Aye.
All opposed? Hearing none, is approved. Next.
You have an easement agreement from Piedmont Natural Gas. Will be upgrading some, replacing and upgrading some lines in the county, including property out at the sheriff's office. This includes both a temporary and a permanent easement. We don't see this to be disruptive to our operations, and we believe that the offer made is reasonable. So I recommend that you approve the easement as presented.
Motion.
Second.
Questions? All in favor, let me know by the vote, sign aye.
Aye.
All opposed, hearing none, it is approved. Next is approval appointment to the chair and vice chair for the Parks and Recreation Advisory Board. Those recommended can take Mike Kevin Atkins. Is there a motion to approve?
So moved.
Second.
Questions? All
in favor, let it be known by the vote, say aye. All opposed, and none is disapproved. After this, can I release this for review, anything for the board's attention there?
Yes, sir.
Is there a motion for approval?
Second.
Question? All in favor, let it be known by the vote, say aye. All opposed, hearing none, it is approved, approval and review of contracts, if there is anything to be brought to the board's attention.
No, sir, to let you know, the first one is, was budgeted in our CIP, and the second is grant funded.
Motion for approval? Second? Questions? All in favor, let it be known by the vote, say aye. All opposed, hearing none, it is approved. Department, report for review. Any questions from the board? Anything on the department? Hearing none, moving on to manager report. Mr. Evans?
Happy to answer any questions, I do want to particularly point out item C. You'll recall that you agreed to set aside $100,000 of the funding we received from the American Rescue Plan Act for programs similar to other emergency repair programs we've administered before. We proposed we were going to administer this program and wanted you to see. This will be more tailored, trying to really focus on the greatest needs that we see come through in other programs. So this will provide assistance for the repair, replacement of even air units, as well as handicap accessibility modifications, wheelchair ramps, handicap showers, those types of things. We'll start taking applications. You'll see how we have the priority criteria. I'm absolutely certain we'll get more applications than we're able to. We have funding to serve.
You said $100,000?
$100,000.
It's not going to do anything.
You're not going to do anything.
It's a start.
It is a start.
It's a start.
It's not on the agenda under manager's report, but I'll note that, as you know, we are part of the Down East Home Consortium. The City of Rocky Mountain is the leading entity. They receive some American Rescue Plan funds as well for the consortium that's supposed to be targeted towards addressing homeless needs. They just got notification they're going to receive some additional funds. That program requires that they have a public hearing to inform the public of the money that's being received, how they plan to use it. So I would ask, Mr. Chairman, if you would call for a public hearing regarding that at the December 5th meeting.
Motion.
Okay.
Questions? All in favor, let it be known by the vote, say aye. All opposed? Hearing none, the public hearing is called. Anything else on the matter?
No, sir.
Commissioners, any reports?
CloudWise received a state grant just under $4 million. They're still going through that paperwork process, if you will, with the state. And so as soon as they finish that, they'll be back. They'll come to the board and update you on their proposed project. Just a reminder, the project, we always knew it would not be enough to cover the whole county. It would cover a defined area. That's what they'll come back and share with the board. Now, you all set aside $1 million of the ARPA money to go towards broadband deployment. We had four companies that were submitting applications. You committed to whichever one was successful that you would commit $50,000 of that money to the project. That helps them with award points, knowing that the county is putting some of our ARPA money in it. So it still leaves just under $1 million, and so we will have that available to either work with CloudWise or another company. That will depend on what they present to us when they come before. So it's an ongoing process, and likely even once they start, it'll probably be several months, if not up to a year, before it's actually up and running and taking in customers. So it's a long process, but it's ongoing.
And on that same note, Centurarians, now right speed. People ask me, do we know anything about
just take over the franchise agreement that the previous company had. And I'm not sure if they're making any changes to their service. And I happen to have been a settlement customer here at Tarboro, and I know they increased my broadband speed at no additional cost. I don't know if they're doing that across their service area or not.
I just called me the week today working in the area. I haven't seen no changes.
Any other questions or comments? You're not attorney?
Yes, sir.
At this time, ladies and gentlemen, we'll be going to closed session to discuss the economic development matter. That must be going to closed session. All in favor, let me know by the vote sign aye. All opposed. You're not. Thank you so much, ladies and gentlemen, for coming. We'll be going to closed session.
Recording stopped.